How do I organize all that? Like all my lore or all my like all this animation stuff? Because the animation stuff, it's mostly layers. Like you have a head layer, a weapon layer, and or a body layer. This should be body. Bodies and weapons and back. They have body, the tail. How do I organize the lore? Well, to start, I have a bunch of folders. So, any art stuff that I draw, I at least put in a folder. So, if it's something that I know for sure it's gonna be relevant in a folder, I will put it there. So, let me see if I can pull out some example, actually. So, whatever I have organized here, I put it in my like lore folder where, I have a big folder that's just Project Black Mask. And this is the general like folder that I put all my lore in. And then I put in who a miscellaneous character are. And once I have, something that's coherent under a coherent theme, I will also put it under its own folder. So, in this example, I have Caudania. I now call it Caudia. I really should call it different, but Caudia is the land of tales, and basically, it's a giant kingdom where the big gimmick is that they have a hierarchy of tales. So, you have like nine-tailed foxes, but then you also have one-tailed foxes. So, right here. You have like one-tailed foxes, they're of the lowest rank, and then you have the highest rank. You have the nine-tailed foxes, highest rank of them all. And basically their entire hierarchy and lifestyle is all around their tails. And it's basically just me having a bunch of different gimmicks of an animal's tail, where it's like, oh, you have a tail that becomes a monster. And it's like a separate monster with this. And of course, you have the Tail Knights, a military unit of, knights, or at least soldiers, who use their tails as shields. And it's kind of just one of those like interesting little deals when it comes to like, okay, what the heck could I actually do with a fox? And this all actually just started with basically just a million different ideas. Like, this was my first ever concept when it came to like the idea of an animal using their tail as a shield. Because from the jump, I want to do something with animals that couldn't just simply be done with like an elf or something. Like, I kind of have a personal, I guess, mindset design, I guess, lore rule that if I design like this, I guess, fancy army that an elf or a dwarf can do, I'm not thinking creative enough with the animals and stuff like that. And I'm not perfect with that. The art stuff that I do with wolves and mages is not as unique as I'd like for it to be, but the Tail Knights, I'd say, are probably my most unique thing that I've done with this, so I'm pretty happy. My ADHD is so bad, I started a personal server for a series I'm working on so I could lay out ideas a bit more with the forum that I just have myself in. It's been helping my for my writing a lot. Yeah, actually, honestly, I will say just the big pro tip with that is to figure out what works with you. If a Discord server works for you, like a private Discord server, that's fine. I keep a bunch of folders, and then I would have Word documents aren't in here, but I would also have Word documents, well, in my case, LibreOffice documents in here, and I would just write a bunch of stuff down. I also have Google Docs, so, if I write in my phone, it exports to Google Docs, and then I'll just copy and paste the Google Docs stuff into my phone and stuff like that. I've recently been told about a app called Milanote, and I haven't tried it out yet, but a few webcomic artists I've spoken with tell me that it's been really helpful, so I want to try that out just to see if it can help my own. I actually don't know if it's ADHD myself, but as a kid I was diagnosed with Asperger's, so it's sort of in that ballpark. So, Milanote is great? Okay. Alright, another endorsement. Fantastic. Yeah, because I bounced off things like Notion and Trello. Yeah, I think it's just the difficulty of setting it up. I think if it's difficult to just whip it out in type, I tend to have a harder time sticking with it. Like, Google Docs is pretty decent. I just type it down. It's fast. Or I'll use a notes app in my phone. Or I will pull out, you know, LibreOffice. Just, you know, type it in. I end up going on hour-long things of it. Big projects make my head spin. Okay, yeah, I totally understand that. Yeah, big projects can be a slog to get through. But one thing that helps make these big projects manageable is to break down your project into smaller and smaller goals. So, in my case, my plan is just to get one character in a animation state. So, currently I'm working on a boss character. And you break it down by, okay, I'm going to work on one animation, which is the run animation. Previously, I worked on a basic walk animation. And next, I worked on a shot animation. And then, once you're in the work on this tiny aspect of animation, you break it down to, you know, other steps. First, I'm going to block it in where I can see, okay, what can I get away with not drawing? So, in my case, I wanted Nad to have the ability to shoot in all directions in the air. So, I did a lot of copying and pasting of his main body. So, it's just him using his main body. And then he's able to just, I reuse the shot for his top body. Like, I separate the body from his arms. And I do that where I already had his shot animations done because I made the shot animations previously. So if you can find a way to save yourself work, that can make a giant difference into how long you'll be able to work before you burn out. So you're not drawing anything new. You're trying to see where can you copy and paste. So this reuses a lot of old animations, Tail Attack. And I didn't even finish this. It's just a sloppy sketch here. But because I reuse his idle animation, I know exactly what new drawings I need to make. Same with the roll. I reuse the roll animation. Like, I reuse the initial crouch for his jump. And I could probably, like, also copy this here. And if you hold the control key while holding while clicking a frame in A-Sprite, you can just automatically copy a frame no matter what. And because I'm able to do this, I could probably change you. All right, that actually looks better. But yeah, you want to figure out ways that you can just save yourself drawing in the start so you'll have energy to actually do your drawing. Which sounds a whole lot like making sense, but what I'm saying is when you're working, try to work smart and not hard. Where, you know, if you can find a way to not draw as much so you can save time on the actual drawing here. So with this roll animation, this is a sloppy block, and then you are just doing a basic drawing here where it's just a basic line art sketch. Nothing's tightened or anything. That's also another thing that I will say. Don't get to your tightening phase until you finish a blocking phase. That's what sketching's for. Like when you're doing pixel art, it's okay to start with a ugly first drawing or make an underdrawing. If you have a process, having that process will at least get your inside monkey brain to stay calm and not be confused at what to do, because you've already made your process in patterns. And obviously making patterns is, it can be a detriment. Like if you have bad habits and you want to break them, that's a whole different ball game with that. But if you have if you can make a process for just drawing and working, that will make things manageable for you. So in my case, I like to plan my animations out before I color them. And that's mostly because I went to 2D animation in college, and that's how I worked. I don't know anything that's smarter, and if there's a faster way to do it, I've never been explained it. And I've never really looked up a tutorial. I'm like, okay, how can I make my layouts faster? And also another way to kind of just make you sure that you're organized is to kind of figure out, okay, what if I had to eliminate, if I was on a heavier deadline, like if I had to get this done in a week, what are the essentials that I absolutely have to get done? Now, project management is a whole different beast, I'd say. I'd say one thing when it comes to, I think, learning how to be a successful artist, quote unquote, is project management, time management. What can you do in your spare time? Do you know what activities you think you're wasting time on that you can make for, art, doing more art? Because I'd say the big secret, I guess I'm gonna be all motivational speaker person here. I'd say the big secret to making, or at least project management, is to mark down and be non-negotiable about the block in time in your day that you're doing. So if you say, okay, I want to do a sketch every day, well, that's kind of nebulous. That's not very good for your monkey brain. You're never gonna remember that. But if you tell yourself at 7 p.m., after work, exactly 7 p.m., you will draw. You will block out and you will set your life up so that you will never miss that 7 p.m. Time. You could be 7 p.m. to 7:30 or 7 p.m. to 8. However that works, 7 p.m. on the dot. Eventually, your brain's gonna be like, okay, this is the pattern I'm in now. 7 p.m., it's drawing time. And do that for, I'd say, a week. Do it for a week. That will get your brain acclimated to it. And because it's only an hour, only 10 minutes, make it a short enough amount of time that your brain's not going to object to it. And set your day up so no one can bother you. No one can, no one can contact you. If, you have your phone on, turn off your phone at 7 p.m. If you have a date at 7 p.m., say no to every date. Say no to a doctor's appointment. Well, I wouldn't say that, but try to reschedule. Try to fight to negotiate alternate dates besides that 7 p.m. date. Sometimes I'll go to a therapist and I will tell her, hey, I can't talk at 7 p.m. How about 6 p.m. or 8 p.m.? And, we'll negotiate and that'll be better. Doctors and, important to people are reasonable like that. If it's like an event or something like that, you might not go to that event because that's your arting time. And of course, it's not an exact formula. If you have a day job at 7 p.m., that's not doable. You'll need to do a different time, like 2 a.m. or, if you have to wake up earlier, you probably will need to do that sometimes. Another thing, so this is one of those rise and grind things where a lot of people take that to an unreasonable extreme when what they really mean is that you should at least figure out a way to make that time work for you. The reason why you have a lot of those rise and grind people being I wake up at six. No, I wake up at 3 in the freaking morning and I work till midnight or whatever. It's kind of that's dumb, and most people can't do that. But most people do wake up an hour early before work to either get some coffee or shower in the morning, or even get some breakfast. I'm talking about myself, really. I shower in the morning, I get breakfast, and I try to meditate. Not really meditate, but kind of just try to sit with my thoughts and try to just be quiet with things if I'm not rushing, because I just don't want to get up out of bed. But usually, if I wake up on time, actually on my alarm, I do have meditation time where, you don't have to be in a lotus pose, but you can just sit at your table. You can even have your coffee brewing, even while you're waiting for your coffee to brew or your tea to boil, just sit down, don't do much, and kind of just get your thoughts, get your cobwebs out. You'll probably be waking up from, personal stress dreams, or you're trying to hyper yourself up for the day, or you're introverted and you're trying to put your mask on so you can be on and stuff like that for social interactions and things like that. And that's usually what that, quote unquote meditation would usually be for, is kind of just getting your brain to just be ready to take on the shitty day. Well, don't call it a shitty day. That's one thing that I'm also trying to just get over, is that negative thing of thinking that everything is going to suck, when it's probably not gonna suck. Obviously, everything can be absolutely positive all the time, but things don't suck all the time. So that's one thing that I try to make sure of, is just saying, all right, you're out of bed. That means that you're able to do what you want to do. Today, you need to do your day job. I know you hate it, but it helps you pay for stuff. It helps you pay your bills. It helps you get extra money to stickers or go to conventions and do other fun things. And it's only for, say, 4 hours. Then you'll cut off. Then you'll go back another 4 hours. Or, you know, it's only for 8 hours. It's only from, like, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. And you're kind of quietly talking to yourself about this to kind of just get yourself understanding the day. Like, this is also a nice time to kind of, like, plan, well, not plan your day, but kind of just checklist the things that you're up to doing. Like, if you have a calendar book, you would be writing down what you want to do in your day and getting yourself to sort your mind is very helpful in terms of just, I'd say, life management, really. Not just time management or art management, just life management. But I've been on a tangent. So after you pretty much just block in your time, which was what this initial conversation was about, when you block in your time and decide that hour is dedicated to this, nothing else, you end up bending your day around that hour, and it makes getting stuff done much easier. And the hard part is done. You actually have decided to sit in your desk. There are other things you can do to prepare yourself. You can prepare your space for, you know, doing drawing. Say I have my stream here. In the morning, I will do little pre-prep stuff, like I will have OBS open before I put my computer to sleep. Or I will have OBS open, I'll have A-Sprite open, I will have my reference folder open, I will have VLC music playing, I'll have Chatterino open. I will have all the stuff that I'm set up to get my things going, just to make it easier to just get started. Now, another way that you'll end up not wanting to do things is you spend a lot of time preparing to get your work done instead of doing the work. And that also just opens up windows for you to kind of just say, all right, this is kind of a pain in the butt and I don't really want to like do anything. And you know, currently I'm doing it right now. I'm kind of like talking while procrastinating and not really drawing and talking really. But that, the basic idea with that is that you are making yourself more prepared and pre-organizing so that when you actually do get into, you know, the actual, you're drawing now, you get into, you know, the flow of your work much faster than if you spent so much time getting your supplies together or opening your folder, waiting for Clip Studio or Photoshop to open with their stupid loading screen. Or even waiting for your computer to turn on, waiting for Discord to go, or, you know, you get a Discord message, you gotta answer it. Like, if you can set up Discord to not boot when you turn on your computer, so, you know, you're not tempted to just look at your Discord messages, don't open email just yet, just, you know, like, hide your email. Like, maybe you can have the Twitch dashboard when you're prepped for streaming, stuff like that. But other than that, try to reduce the amount of distractions that you have to get yourself started working ASAP. Another thing that I could probably recommend in terms of work tips is, so you have all your stuff prepped. You know, have your block of time. So once you have your block of time, then you're going to break down, you know, what you need to do in like a broad you know, little workflow time. So this part of that will take a lot of personal experimentation. I don't know how you draw. I just know how I draw. Like, everything I say, take it with a grain of salt, because I can't help you help yourself. Like, you gotta be the one to get yourself to know what the heck that you want out of your drawing stuff. Like, this is that moment where I'm like, okay, you do actually need to pull yourself by your bootstraps. That sort of thing. Because I personally cannot help you with what you need to do for your art thing. So, if you want to make an animated short, well, you're gonna need to plan, you know, what's the story of your short? What's your short about? What do the characters need to do in your short? What the characters' interest in doing your short? What's going to stop your characters from doing what your characters want in that short? Figuring out that story like that. And then you're going to be planning the broad strokes plot beats, where you're storyboarding. You're not really making animation, but kind of just making storyboards and little comic strips. God, just boom, boom, boom. This happens, and this happens, and this happens. And you're able to visually see that. And after that, you will actually get into refine the animation. That part is where you will just be sketching and laying out where those movements will go. So you'll probably be doing stuff like this initially, and not doing any polishing, just little animation. And you'll just be doing that. And afterward, you'll probably be polishing, like, the next day. And the next day, you'll be coloring it. And the next day, you'll have maybe, like, an 11-second scene after 3 months or a month or something like that. And a lot of it is, you know, you get faster as you go, so don't get discouraged if you're not cranking out a TikTok animation every week, because one, most of those, like, TikTok animators have a team. Like, if you're watching Chicken Nuggets and you're seeing, like, an animation every day, you're kind of like, that person has a team. Like, that person has an actual full-blown team. If we're seeing Hella Boss every month, you're like, that's an entire team that's also working on, like, another cartoon. Like, they're good. You are probably one person. Don't feel bad that you can't crank out, like, full-blown, full-color animations. Like, I'd say most animators on YouTube just drop out storyboards, slideshows, and animatics, because full-blown animation is unviable alone. Well, it's not unviable, it's just timely full-blown animation is unviable. I mean, it's doable if you never sleep, but sleeping is good. You should sleep, because if you don't sleep, your metabolism will actually get worse. There's actual, I think, medical science that says that the less you sleep, the less fat you're able to burn, because it's using its fat reserve. You're using your fat reserves to have the energy to stay awake. So you will burn less fat because the body's telling itself, hey, you need to stay awake, so I'm gonna use your fat to give you the rest of the energy that you need. And you will just end up, like, being, oh snap, crap. Okay, but yeah, you'll end up just getting fatter when you're you'll just end up getting fatter because you sleep less and you're not, you know, you're not taking care of your body. So you gotta remember, like, actual, I guess, you know, make sure you take care of your body, drink water, take your vitamins, all that Hulk Hogan stuff, and make sure that you don't die for this job. As cool as doing art is, it's not worth dying for. It really isn't. Like, you really shouldn't be dying to do more cartoons of animals, because that's entirely dumb. Ew. So don't. You know, and that's all I can really say is, you see that super thing? Don't do it. You know, that don't do unhealthy things to your body that's going to end up killing yourself because you're unwilling to compromise your I'm losing my train of thought with this, but because you don't want to compromise, like, I think, to put it shortly, because you don't want to rest, you're putting yourself in more danger. I'm trying to, like, do a bunch of dumb words with them thing, but that's basically the gist of what I'm saying is, it's good to not do insane stuff on your body just because you're passionate about working on a thing, your dream project. Obviously, having passion is good, but having passion will make you vulnerable to being taken advantage of by assholes with money who want to work you to death. Because you're passionate.